I heard a lady say once, if you learn to sail, she had built this great empire of cosmetics. She said, if you learn to sail, her daddy told her, you will never starve. And I thank goodness, first of all, as that man would tell me years earlier, you're an American, nobody can take that away from you, and I learned to sail. I became the champion of the world, and now I'm the king of the George Foreman. I'm the king of the grill, and I'm always trying to start another business. I hit the floor every morning thinking, boy, that was yesterday. What have you done today? You gotta keep searching and keep finding products. You gotta keep working, because no one will work for you better than you work for yourself. And I heard some of you may have a couple questions for me, and I'd be happy to answer those questions for you. Let me tell you something first. I was hit first in the 40s. You know, the doctor. I started hitting back in the 50s. In the 60s, I obtained an Olympic gold medal. In the 70s, I became the heavyweight champion of the world. In the 80s, I really made the sports writer scratch their head. In the 90s, I became the oldest man ever to be champion of the world. And in this new millennium, I am the king of grilling. Looking at me is like seeing something you'll seldom see, like a total eclipse. So if you go home one day and say, well, you know, I need to ask, and I should have asked, shame on you. I'll allow you to ask, and they have the question designed that may help you. I know I've needed a lot of help. And a lot of the help that I've gotten has come from people who had already been there and back. If you want to make it, sitting here in the United States, there's no excuse. You can make it. There's always something new to be built. Always a new business, a new product. If you've had it all and you've lost it, so what? They give you a reason to jump up and do it again. I did it twice, heavyweight champion of the world twice, within 20 years. First question.
Muhammad Ali passed away this year, and he knocked you out, and yet you are the one who can take a punch because you're still sharp and in a very brutal sport. So what made the difference? Why is it that Muhammad Ali suffered from Parkinson's disease and so forth, and you seem to survive fine? What's the difference?
You know, heroes don't truly suffer. Heroes never suffer. They just have proof of what they did. And that's the way I looked at Muhammad Ali. What a hero. He had proof that he had given all he had. I used to walk around, because I'm old enough to remember World War II veterans sitting around there talking to you and enjoying it. Then later on that evening, they take off, after they boasted, take off their leg. I said, what, you had just one leg? Whatever they had, it was just proof that they were there. And that's what I feel about Muhammad Ali. That was my best friend. I miss him, and I wish Parkinson was only brought on by boxing. Then all we'd have to do is outlaw boxing. But it's deeper than that. A lot of us need to get to work and get a lot of funds together so we can fight that disease. And we can help it in the future. And listen to this, ZYXWDUTSRQPONMLKJIHGFEDCBA. Now, that's the alphabet's backwards. Before I fought Muhammad Ali, I could say that before.
Mr. Foreman, have you ever had a chance to go visit Joe Louis's grave in Arlington Cemetery?
Most wonderful time of my life was to visit Joe Louis's grave in the Arlington Cemetery. Oh, and I was so proud because I really knew Joe Louis. And I think everyone should get a chance to be up in the area, to go. It's right in Arlington. Joe Lewis is great, y'all. Thank you, Pastor.
May I give you this, sir?
Yes. You know what? I still have that love affair. No one is ever going to come to me after that.
What was your relationship to Muhammad Ali in that first boxing match where you lost?
How old are you?
12.
I'm gonna beat your dad up, that's what I'm gonna do. But Muhammad Ali and I were great friends. We were always good friends because he was a joker. Always made you feel like he was listening to what you had to say. So when I made the fight for Africa, I called myself doing him a favor. I had no idea he was gonna whip me. But after the fight, that's when he became my enemy, taking my title in the way he did. We were friends beforehand. All the year. 12, 12. Once again, 12, he told me twice.
A quick two-part question. Why are you so complimentary of Mr. Ali after he beat you? I mean, that's very hard for most boxers. I mean, you see Duran is not super complimentary of Mr. Leonard, but you're very gracious. How can there be no animosity when someone basically knocked you out?
You beat me and knocked me out, I'll be your friend too. Anyone want to be friends with me? Step up here, let's fight it out right here. But in reality, we had a lot in common, more in common than we had not. He was a good friend of mine. I learned to love him.
And very quickly, why wasn't there ever a rematch? There was talk about a rematch. The first seven rounds were very competitive. Why didn't that ever happen?
It wasn't the seventh round, the first seven round, it was that eighth round that caused the trouble. One was scared and the other was glad of it. We never fought again. Hope I answered that for you.
Did you ever spend time with Muhammad Ali outside of the ring?
I spent a lot of time with Muhammad Ali outside the ring. We became great friends, but still wasn't the kind of guy you want to go on a fishing trip with. Talk too much.
Mr. Foreman, I'm so impressed with your comeback. Introduced my kids to you through YouTube. We watched a lot of your fights, and I just really think you're a great boxer, a great man. I am interested though, who hits you the hardest in your career?
Now, you know, it's not like ice cream and stuff where you can say, that was good, that was not good. Back then, it was in Las Vegas, one of the first major heavyweight fights. I fought Run Lyle. Run Lyle hit me so hard it didn't hurt. All I can remember is like, wow, my legs are just, I'm melting. I don't know, he hit me so hard it didn't hurt, but I kept getting up. And he beat me so bad that finally he got tired and fainted and I won the fight. He hit me hardest though, Run Lyle.
Out of your 80 plus fights, which boxer have you wish you could have gone against that you haven't?
Oh, you know, in the dressing room before a boxing match is the most frightening time of your life. You sit back there thinking, why am I doing this?
I know.
Are you crazy? I said, are you crazy? You said you would never do it again. If you could live through that, you would never say, I wish I had fought someone, because beforehand is that dressing room where it's so frightening. You know, they said Mike Tyson and George Foreman, but then every time I think about Mike Tyson, I said,
hey, George, I got your grill. It's a great product. I love it. Tell me about how you got started with that. Did you design that yourself, or did you just put your name on a product that somebody brought to you?
Well, it was a product that I have developed in its present form. It'll turn out to be a beautiful piece of furniture. And once I put my name on it, we just made it better and better, even with griddles on it. But it was a product, and I did not invent it. I just marketed it.
Good evening, George.
Yeah, hello, my
hello.
Friend.
Can you tell us about your diet and your current exercise routine? How do you stay healthy?
Well, before I went back into boxing, I told you about my weight. I'd get up every morning and eat a dozen eggs. I really did. But when I went back into training, I got serious. I only ate 11. The good thing about being an athlete, if you don't take care of yourself, you're just not going to live long.
So how about exercise?
When I built the last home I built, it was a big gym, about 300 square feet of nothing but gym, where I'd lift weights. I still got a muscle too. And I lift weights, treadmill, and most importantly these days, the bicycle. And recumbent bike, yeah. And I do a lot of that. I even have a punching bag. I hit it once or twice and said, that's enough.
Mr. Foreman, can you tell us a little bit about how you went from being an athlete to an entrepreneur?
I had 10 years out of boxing where I didn't even make a fist. And I decided to be an evangelist at the Church of Lord Jesus Christ because the last fight I had in the 70s, I had an experience in my dressing room where I was dead and alive again. I saw blood on my hand and forehead. I started screaming, Jesus Christ has come alive in me. And everybody thought I was crazy. They rushed me to intensive care. And I lived through it. I said, I got a second chance to live. And I became a preacher. So I go out on the street corners, it's the only way I can preach. And people would pass me by like a freight train did the old hobos. And one day I decided, I'm gonna say who I am. And I talked about George Foreman and talked about my religion, especially about Jesus Christ, and they would stop for a moment. I learned to sell, and I fell in love with selling. Went back to boxing, started selling. That I hate the age 50 is not a death sentence. I sold that pretty good. Then Doritos, McDonald's, Pepsi Cola, everybody was on that bandwagon. And one fella said, George, you're doing so well, why don't you make your own product? Make these other folks rich. I said, how much you gonna pay me? They said, no. Let's become partners. And we started a partnership, we call it in those days the joint ventures, and I'd have the lion's share and I'd sell a grill. No money down, and I started working. Before you know it, we sold 120 million of those things worldwide. The grill was a success.
Who were your heroes as a child when you were growing up, and who are your heroes today?
Oh, so many heroes. I remember looking, I saw Jimmy Brown, he took his helmet off on the football field one day. I remember thinking, he had this mustache. I said, that's the way I want to look. I started scraping my face so that I could grow a mustache. And John Wayne, I wanted to walk like him. Oh, man. Johnny Unitas, the story was that he had made one telephone call, a 10-cent telephone call to the Baltimore Colts, and he got his chance to. I had these heroes, and anything they would say, I listened like that. And I think Mary Kay, I think she was the one who said that about Dad told her, learn to sell.
Thank you.
Mr. Foreman, sorry, I have to go, my tip chips. You mentioned your run-ins with the police. We see a lot of young black men who are having run-ins with the police. We're seeing a lot of riots. We're seeing a lot of violence on the streets with Black Lives Matter. What message do you have for the people involved with Black Lives Matter? You mentioned your love affair with the American flag. What's your message for people who might have a different opinion and who are affiliated with Black Lives Matter?
You know, the best thing that ever happened to me, and I think it's the best thing that happened to most everybody. And to be honest with you, as I've traveled around the world, the best thing that has happened to the world probably in the last 200 years is the United States of America. Everyone. Everyone is going to have an opportunity to search it out for themselves. And the conclusion is, if you love your country, you can make it a better place. If you love it. It's like every year you got to go out on a farm and cut hay and pack it away. There's no one year fix it, and it's going to be fixed forever. Oh, I fell in love with this country, and I just think all things are possible through it. That was like that right hand I didn't see Muhammad Ali throw. You know, he hit me with the fast. The right hand was not hard, but I was like, ooh, oops. Next thing I know, wham! So I didn't see that happen. It was fast, and it was sneaky, and it hurt. But not the heaviest punch, just quick. Now, I hope I've added to your adventure. Remember, start from the bottom, there's nothing wrong. If you start from the bottom, there's nothing but all the way back up you can do. God bless you.